folks, it's the big game, and the home team is trailing. There isn't much time, but the coach has an ace up his sleeve. It's Farrell, tall, slim job, catching passes. And now Farrell's in the game. This is the play he's been waiting for. He's going down the field. He's out in the clear. Here comes the pass. It's perfect. It's going to be a touchdown. Oh, he dropped it. He dropped it. It was right in his hands, and he muffed it.
Poor Farrell. He'll get other chances, of course, in the next game. As for this game, well, you have to make every chance count if you want to win. We're talking about selling, not football. But when you've qualified a prospect as a potential buyer, when you've made a careful pre-approach to suit your presentation to his needs and desires, and when you've made a favorable impression, double-checked your pre-approach data, and then change that favorable impression to a positive interest in your proposition, then, like Farrell, you're in the clear with a perfect pass on its way. And it's up to you whether you make the play or muff it. You've started on the path to a successful sale with the development of an efficient system of prospecting. Your system may depend on any combination of methods, such as personal observation, keeping your eyes and ears open for any hints of potential prospects. Or the endless chain method, turning every sale into the opportunity for a new sale by asking a satisfied customer who else might be interested in your product or service. Or a center of influence method, carefully developing the confidence and cooperation of acquaintances who are in a position to refer you to many logical prospects. The effectiveness of the system you use can be measured by the kind of prospect file and time you have left to devote to your selling efforts. When you've qualified a prospect, you are moving down that path to your pre-approach, picking up every fact about his personality, needs, and desires. And you're planning for an approach and presentation to fit those facts. In making your pre-approach, you will have to use every source at your disposal. Fellow salesmen, regular customers, newspapers, home office resources, personal investigation, and a lot of hard thinking and planning. Remember, you must measure your pre-approach efforts against the prize you want to win. Your approach is the first actual contact with the customer. You have to get past that point before you are ready to sell. But if you look and act as though you have real service to offer your prospect, he will decide to see you. And if you arouse his curiosity and interest in your proposition, your prospect will want to hear about it. When you've reached that stage, you've come a long way on your path to a sale, and your goal is in sight. But you can't relax. There's still a lot of hard work ahead. You'll have to demonstrate your proposition, meet your prospect's objections, and then close the sale. Right now, you have your prospect's interest, yes. But you have to change that interest into a positive desire for your proposition. And you have to give him the confidence and conviction that your particular solution of his problem or need is the best one for him. And finally, you will have to get him to act now before you've made that sale. Here's Bill Bates, an oil burner salesman. You may remember in our film on prospecting that Bill turned a dull train trip to his home office into an opportunity for a sale by keeping his eyes and ears open. When he noticed a man who had missed the train, he thought very little about it. But when this tardy commuter's card-playing friends began to grumble about George missing the train again on account of his old-fashioned coal furnace, that hit home. Let's let Bill tell the story.
Well, I offered myself as a fourth for their game and soon found out that their missing pal's name was George Kimball, that he had a wife and two children and owned his own home right in our town up on Birch Road. It seems he missed the train frequently and the story was always the same, down in the basement shoveling coal when he should have been on his way to the train. Well, after I'd pumped his card-playing friends for all the information I could get, I went to work on the sources I could find in our town. I called up the real estate agent who had sold them their home 5 years before.
Wait a moment, Bill. How did you know which agent to call?
That's simple. I make it my business to know most of the agents in town, and a couple of telephone calls did it. The agent told me that the house was large and well-built, but about 25 years old. It had a large cellar with a coal furnace, and large coal bin in the cellar with an outside chute. Kimball had been hesitant at the time, but Mrs. Kimball had liked the neighborhood and the roominess of the house. Well, I had all the facts, and that afternoon I called on Mrs. Kimball. She was very pleasant and pleased with my compliments about their home. She thought automatic oil heat would be nice, but with all the other things they needed, it would have to wait. I asked to see the furnace, and she led me to the basement. After a little discussion and a little guiding on my part, she admitted that there were disadvantages with it. Coal dust, removing ashes, and once in a while she had to act as fireman when the temperature got down on cold afternoons. I managed to meet the kids, too. Billy was quite a boy, all fired up with his latest fancy, an electric train. Before I left, Mrs. Kimball had agreed that I could return at 8:30 that evening to see her husband. Though she repeated that she didn't feel they could or should spend any money right now. I didn't have much time, but I prepared a rough plan view of the house and grounds as I had seen them. And then another of the same plan as it could be, with an estimate of the total cost. I figured that these, along with my regular demonstration material, were all I would need. That night, I arrived at the Kimballs promptly at 8:30. He was cordial enough, but obviously a little tense and defensive. Said right away that he and his wife had discussed my visit and had definitely made up their minds that they were not prepared to do anything now. Too many obligations. Besides, though their coal furnace might not be the latest thing, they were well satisfied with it. Mr. Kimball, I said, I certainly agree that this is a decision for you and Mrs. Kimball to make on your own. I know you won't go into anything that's not worth your while. But I also know from friends of yours that you are the kind of businessman who likes to get all the facts before making a decision. That's really why I'm here, to give you the facts. I know you'll make your own decision. His tension eased a little at that, and he remembered to ask me to sit down. I explained about my chance meeting with his card partners, leaving out his train missing episode, course, and then passed along a few of the nice compliments they had paid him. That's why I'm here to see you, Mr. Kimball, I said. I knew a man with your business judgment had probably never had the facts that prove you're losing money every day with a coal furnace, while denying yourself and your family the pleasure and safety of automatic heat. He looked a little skeptical, but he was interested. I knew I had made a strong claim, but I was prepared to prove it. I pulled out my rough sketch and handed him a pencil. Suppose you check me, I said. Now this is your present cellar plan. Furnace, coal bin, coal chute. That's about a 10-ton bin, isn't it, Mr. Kimball? It covers quite an area there. Here's your cellar door and your ash cans outside. Now, here is your basement room again with your entire heating plant intact, but no coal bin or chute, no ash cans outside. There won't be any coal dust, soot, or ashes to track up into the house. Where the coal bin was, I've made a little layout for Billy's train so that he doesn't have to put his tracks together every time he wants to play with it. Of course, there's a lot more I could have indicated, such as a workbench and storage cabinets, because you see, your cellar has become another room in your home instead of a large coal bin. There are a lot of things I can't picture here, of course. The ease of simply setting a dial instead of shoveling coal, shaking grates, carrying out ashes, washing dirt from your hands, face, clothes, and trying to keep the house free of the soot, dirt, and ash dust that seeps through it. Neither could I picture the comfort and healthful safety of constant, even heat that eliminates those shivering mornings as well as the dangers of overheating one moment and chills the next. With automatic heat, Mr. Kimball, you need never worry about your children playing on the floor. Mr. Kimball agreed that it looked fine, but he said it looks expensive too, and we're just not ready for it. Maybe later when things clear up a little. I got out a pad and said, let's jot down a few facts. How much coal did you burn last year? About 15 tons? We figured the cost of coal against savings in oil fuel through the efficiency of evenly regulated heat. It was quite impressive. But he said it was the initial cost of installation that bothered him. How soon do you think your fire bricks will have to be replaced, I asked. He hadn't thought of that. I explained that my check indicated he would have to do the job soon, that if he installed a conversion burner, the fire brick would be replaced at the same time at no extra cost. I told him that the entire installation, outside tank, burner, and thermostat, had been estimated exactly by our service people, and that its cost, compared to the yearly savings in fuel, the convenience to him, and the healthful comfort and extra pleasure he would give to his family alone, was worth it. I turned to Mrs. Kimball and said, "I know you will appreciate the savings in cleaning and the actual worth of longer life for your rugs, curtains, wallpaper, and interior finish." He had bought the house, he hadn't hesitated on the coal furnace. He admitted that, but he'd gotten used to it and didn't mind it. Then I turned to Mrs. Kimball again and said, "But you wouldn't keep butter in a well these days, would you? And you don't light the oil lamps or trot out the horse and buggy today." That seemed to ring the bell for both of them. "Mr. Kimball," I said, "your home is worth more and is more saleable with modern automatic heating." He said he had no intention of selling. I agreed, but said, "A man of your ability might either be transferred to a key position in a branch or accept a new position that might change your plans. This is an investment that is as sound in principle as owning your own home. Mr. Kimball, it pays you, not only in fuel savings, but in extra safety, comfort, and convenience. And your investment is always there." "What about electric power failure?" he asked. "We'd be without any heat." "We live in a modern age, don't we?" I laughed. "Our whole civilization, food, transportation, everything, is geared to the public services we've developed. That's why they're so reliable. Can you remember a power failure that was more than a matter of minutes?" While he was still thinking this over, I described the complete service we offered. Automatic fuel delivery, so that there was never any need to think about heating problems. Go away for a weekend, and find your home the right temperature on return. "What about breakdowns?" he asked. I laughed. "Mr. Kimball, I've been talking automatic oil heat, but I haven't gotten down to showing you just how foolproof our burner is.